Hello, Phil Croshaw again here from Passions, and in this episode, we welcome actor David Michaels to the show. Enjoy.
Speak of the devil. You'd think that forming a government might be more important than having lunch.
Alexander?
Brian?
Hello, Elspeth.
Hello, Brian. You know James Morpeth?
You've known me since Cambridge, Elspeth. Do you honestly think I would take bribes?
If you want to give us your side of the story, I'm more than happy to arrange an interview.
I've already said I know nothing about these so-called offshore accounts. Enjoy your lunch.
I don't want to say anything that could potentially inflame an already volatile situation.
Yeah, but you just haven't you?
Look. Let's be clear here. We face grave challenges. And people are going to have to put aside their narrow partisan interests and pull together for the nation. Because there are some people, backed by certain media organisations with their own agenda, who simply do not want to see a second coalition and will do everything they can to derail us.
Tell me, how long is it now since you had a drink?
This is a lovely house, isn't it? Must have quite a history, eh?
Apparently the original bits are Elizabethan. The family were accusants, that's why there's a small chapel.
No, I really meant since it became a clinic. You know, the patients. You must have a few stories, eh?
You should know better, Brian. Anyway, I only came here in 2003.
Well, lucky you. And I suppose your poor predecessor, he had to retire, did he?
No, he left.
Really? Can't imagine anyone leaving a place like this. Don't tell me. He had a falling out with this lot here, eh? Eh?
I don't think it was an entirely happy association. Let's just say Dr. McCormack felt his future lay more in the direction of Harley Street.
I didn't mean it to happen.
You just can't help yourself, can you?
Because I know exactly what will happen. Babs will fall for you, you'll lose interest, and leave her heartbroken.
I won't.
End it now.
I can't.
Why not? You've never had a problem walking away in the past.
This is not about me and your mother.
Does Tanya know? And you used to be so discreet.
Babs is a remarkable woman.
Yes, she is. And I don't want to see her getting hurt.
I don't want to hurt her.
Well, I'd love to believe you, but you know what? I don't think you've changed.
Hey, also, war erfolgreich? Maybe I can do something for you.
Wieso? Was meinen Sie?
Sie suchen einen Job für Ihren Mann auf einer Farm. Ich habe einen Freund hier bei der Armee. Er braucht jemanden. Ich könnte mit ihm sprechen.
Das wäre aber sehr nett von Ihnen.
You're very beautiful, Mrs. Rillick.
I'm third line down. Let alone an imminent threat from Saddam. In other words, it shows he has the means, but it does not demonstrate that he has the motive to attack his neighbours, let alone the West. Mm-hmm. Do you know from any discussions that you had with John Scarlett whether these were taken up with him, whether he accepted any of those?
Well, I think what Jonathan is doing there is making an observation, which is actually consistent with what John Scarlett had been doing. I mean, this dossier is sometimes described as the Prime Minister making the case for war. What it was actually doing was setting out, in as factual a way as possible, the reason why the government were concerned about Saddam's WMD programs.
Hello, and a very warm welcome to this episode of Passions. And today, I'm delighted to be joined by David Michaels. And some of you may recognise David, some of you might know his name because he's been on the telly a little bit. But I'm not going to try, as I say with all my guests, I'm not going to try and explain about David and who he is and what he does because he's much better at it. So a very warm welcome to Passions, David. Tell us who you are and tell us what your passion is.
Hello. Well, yes, my name is David Michaels, and my passion is, and has been since I was about 9 or 10, is acting. That is my passion. It's what I do. It's what I do as a job. It's what I do to make money. But I do it because I have to. I've always thought that acting is a calling. It is like entering the church. You basically have no option. If you have the calling to become an actor, you have the calling, and that's why you sort of stick with it. So I did have the calling when I was about 9 or 10. It took me quite a while to realize that that's what it was, but that is my passion. That's what I do. That's what I love.
Fantastic. So did you actually, you said you were 9 or 10. How did that come about then? Were you kind of by parents or whatever, you were thrown onto the stage or did you volunteer? What happened?
My mum was in something called the Wilmslow and Alderley Amateur Operatic Society. So there was always that knocking around and going to see those shows. And they also used to do an old time music hall in spring and then the main shows around about November. So there was that. But my mum was just in the chorus. But really, I went to see a film called Candleshoe. Right at the Rex in Wilmslow. So when I was about 11 or 12 maybe, and in it was Jodie Foster, a very young Jodie Foster, and it was the first time I'd seen young people in a film, and that was the sort of ignition for that. I'd thought about it, but I didn't know, I couldn't process it. And then I saw this film, and I saw these young people. Because it's full of young people. The film is about something about a stately home. I should look it up, see what it's about. But it was that made me think, gosh, right. Wow. Okay. I could be an actor. I didn't want to be a child actor, but it was then you kind of go, God, young people act. And so it was that. That was the ignition. But all the kindling was there from before, as it were.
Right. Okay. So was the school encouraging of that, or were they, what you might call in the traditional sense, trying to mould you into the person to go into the McDonald's or the factory or the accountancy practice?
Well the school so what happened is that I then joined Wilmslow Guild junior section at about 14, 15, something like that, and so started doing plays with them. There wasn't drama at my school. I went to Wilmslow Grammar School in Cheshire. There wasn't drama. It didn't exist, but I had a brilliant English teacher called Mrs. Chaffee, who knew I wanted to be an actor, and put on a, it wasn't just for me, I don't think, but anyway, put on a production of Twelfth Night, and I played Sir Andrew Aguecheek at school in Twelfth Night at the age of 17. So I think I was in the lower sixth, and then I produced, when I was in the upper sixth, I produced a school review, which had never been done before and was never done again. And so I produced that and got all these sketches together and got teachers involved and got teachers to do these sketches that I found. And I got this, I remember getting a rugby playing, I mean, at the age of 17, he had the bushiest moustache, a guy called Chris Coburn. And I got him to play a woman in Mariah Martin and the Murder at the Red Barn, you know, and so I managed to get lots of people to do extraordinary things in these sketches. As I say, it was never done again. It was a brilliant thing to do. But then in a way, the turning point for me, and I will never forget, our head teacher was called Mrs. Butter. It was Mrs. Butter, not Butters, but Mrs. Butter. And she introduced something when I was in the upper sixth, that she invited all the sixth formers, because that was a time when people didn't stay to do sixth form very often. You know, there weren't, it wasn't, you didn't have to stay to do the sixth form and do your A-levels. So the sixth form was really quite small. And I had auditioned at Central, Rada and Bristol Old Vic by then. So I was in the upper sixth and hadn't got a place at those. And I went for my interview with Mrs. Butter, and she said, "So, David, what are you going to do?" And I said, "Well, I don't know. I've auditioned at three drama schools, haven't got in. So I think I'll probably have to join the bank, because my elder brother was in NatWest, I think. And so my parents said, "Well, what you can do is you can get a proper job, and then you can do acting as part time." You know, I mean, you know, that's, it seems crushing, but they were just trying to help out. Anyway, Mrs. Butter said, "I'll never forget it." She said, "Oh, David, we can't see you joining the bank," which is just amazing, you know. So she went, she left the room, and she went to her deputy, Mrs. Davis, and got her to ring up Manchester Polytechnic School of Theatre to get me an audition. So she got me an audition for the Manchester Polytechnic School of Theatre. I went for the audition. I was recalled the same day. And the way they did it then is, so by the time I left, I knew I'd got a place. So then I went to drama school, having thought, "Oh, well, I don't know what to do now," having attempted it and thought, "Well, maybe I'll do," because then you have to wait another year to reapply and audition. So yes, I owe a lot of it to Mrs. Butter. I do.
Fantastic.
You know, she was just there at that moment in my life to go, "Oh, David, we can't have you joining the bank." I mean, it was just brilliant.
They're almost like crossroads, aren't they? What they call now sliding doors moments from
Absolutely.
The movie, where that one split second decision that takes you on a completely different journey.
That's right. And if she hadn't been there, if she hadn't been my headmistress at that time, if she hadn't instigated this chat with sixth formers, you know, I might have found my way, but it wouldn't have happened. So I went to drama school at 18, which was thrilling.
And did you find, would you say you're ambitious back in those days? Did you have a serious vision and drive to be making a living out of it? Maybe, you know, the next Gregory Peck or whatever, you know, did you have that ambition?
Absolutely. Yeah. And I still have quite a fierce ambition. It gets dented because it's a brutal profession, but then the flip side is no one's telling you to do it, so if you really can't stand it, go and do something else. Yes, I was fiercely ambitious in a nice way. I wasn't ruthless, but I always felt I would be. I mean, everyone at drama school thinks they'll be successful, you know, because they do, and they should be there if they don't think they're going to be successful. But yes, I really did think, and I had really good moments of success even at drama school. So I did the BBC came to the school to look for an actor to play the son in a something called a drama called The Family Rules, and I went up for it and I got it. So that was in the second term of my third year, and then that director then went to Yorkshire TV to do a schools thing called How We Used to Live. And she got an audition for that. So then I took the first term of my third year off to do this series in Yorkshire for Yorkshire Television. And in summer before that, I did something called Crown Court, because I got an agent on the back of The Family Rules. So, you know, I was working a lot, actually, when I look back in television at that point, really, really, before I'd even left drama school.
That so takes me back. Because I remember How We Used to Live. I used to love that program. I had no idea I'd be interviewing you all these years later. And I even remember Crown Court as well. It was 1 o'clock, I think, something, wasn't it? Every day. It was fantastic.
It was every day. And then on the Friday, that was the real jury. The real jury made the decision. Do you remember?
That's right. Yes, I do remember. Yes, I do remember. Oh, absolutely fantastic time. Right, okay, so I guess it's fair to say then you have to have bags of motivation and arguably bags of resilience too, to take the knockbacks.
Absolutely. Bags of resilience and bags of motivation, because you have to be your own. You have to be your own motivator. I mean, you get knocked back quite a lot. You really do. And it's sort of easier. You can roll with the punches a lot when you're younger because you're just going with the flow. The older you get, it's harder to take those knocks sometimes. But yeah, your resilience, it's an extraordinary profession because you have to have, in many ways, you have to have the hide of a rhino, but the sort of the brain and the heart of a child, because you have to be able to play and be free and expressive and, you know, and all those things like a three-year-old with a pot of paint. But also to get there, you've got to have had extremely tough skin. It's in many ways, I often think that the job of being an actor and is coping with unemployment and coping with the downtime, because coping with jobs is the great thing. You know, that's the bread, that's the joy, that those are the cherries. But you know, for instance, I now haven't worked for over a year and can't really see, you know, I could get some kind of telly between now and maybe the end of the year. I know there is work going on. I've done some self-tapes for things, some nice things. But it's really, really strange out there to at the minute to be an actor, as it is for so many other professions. I'm not just saying just as an actor, but, you know, so many people, musicians, writers, all sorts of people. Yeah,
I mean, absolutely. I was going to ask you that because obviously we're doing this interview in the middle of January, so 2021. So those that will figure out that that's right slap bang pretty much in the middle of the global pandemic, which is impacting so many people. And I was interviewing a guy called Gary England, who was a producer of the Christmas Carol show in London. And I interviewed him about it, and he'd worked really hard to get this show on. It was Brian Conley and that kind of thing back to the latter end of last year. And then just suddenly they kicked London into tier four after two performances. And, you know, obviously he was absolutely devastated. And I think that whole entertainment arena, I mean, obviously you see a lot of work going on behind the scenes, which appears to be like the soaps and such, like where they're tending to follow guidelines and follow rules. But is it fair to say that there's a significant amount of production than there ever would have been before?
Massive. Pandemic? I mean, massive. You see, the soaps can do it because they're all self-contained, aren't they? They've got their studio, they've got their building, all the actors know each other. You know, and they're doing scenes with plexiglass in between them, and partners come in apparently and do kissing scenes. And if you do watch something like EastEnders or Coronation Street, you'll go, well, that was a weird shot. And you realize it's because, you know, they were there and then they had to get somebody else out, bring his real partner in so they can do the clinch. And it just looks rubbish. You know, I'm not criticizing them because they're just trying to make it happen. But then I see that both Emmerdale and Coronation Street have suspended filming at the minute. I think anybody that is at this moment striving to make it work is amazing. Absolutely amazing. Like Chris England trying to put on a panto. I happened to be in town the Monday before the Tuesday of that December lockdown. And I was in by the Dominion, I think. No, the other one, where they were having the big panto with Nigel Havers, and you know, there were audience coming through, and they were going through arches and having their bags checked. They were having that, but they're also being sprayed. I mean, you know, you think, God, you're probably doing it to 800 people as opposed to almost 2,000, simply to get it on, and it's remarkable. And then the next day we went to tier four, so you just think, well, all that effort, all that money. You know, I think it's the arts will survive because it always survives. But I think the problem, for instance, with this government is I think they think it will survive, and therefore they have given some money. They have given some money. But what the arts brings into this country is nowhere near what they're now supporting it with, you know. And it's not just the knock on is huge. You know, the West End obviously is dark. But that means, I mean, and so are the restaurants, but there's just the theatre brings people in to town centres, you know, to the Library Theatre, to Sheffield Crucible, you know, and restaurants and coffee shops, they all feed off that. So I think it is absolutely devastating.
What do you think will happen on the other side, if you like, of this, in terms of people's propensity to go back into a theatre or a venue or a music venue for that matter. Do you think the youngsters, especially the youngsters, I suppose, well, both really, do you think they'll just go rushing back in, or do you think it'll be very, very tentative?
I think given the go ahead, actors will be first there. You know, they will do it. If you've had the vaccine, which is a whole other area of what we have to get into, you know, because people will have to be able to prove they've had the vaccine, you know. But actors will be first to go back to work and be in a rehearsal room or be free to do some telly, of which there is still telly being made. But within that, how do you get 800 people in the audience yet? You know, so I think there's such a long way to go for theatre. I really do. And that's why, as we are talking about passion, that is my passion. I love telly, you know, but telly is only when you have a really longish part that you can nip and tuck and work on, which I've had sometimes in the past. Whereas in theatre, you know, you're playing the lead in a play. You've got so many. You got your journey, and it's you're in complete control of it. You start at 7:30 and it finishes at 9:45, and there's nobody else involved in that, you know, other than the other actors in stage. It's you. It's theatre is an actor's medium, so I think theatre, God, has such a long way to go before I will be back in a rehearsal room. To be honest, I can't see it. I cannot see it this year, Phil.
Yeah, it's an absolute tragedy.
I can't actually see myself going up for a theatre job till the spring of next year. Because I don't know how
tough.
Because, you know, Chris England must have lost a lot of money trying to, and that was him assuming with Brian Connolly, he'll get people coming, he'll get the bums on seats. But, you know, the last show I did, which was Curious Incident of the Dog in the Nighttime, which was a tour in England, in the UK, and then we toured it to the rest of the world, like Melbourne and Amsterdam and Hong Kong. I'm not going to be able to do that for a very long time. You know, that's
the very idea of getting on a plane at the moment, anywhere.
International tour, absolutely. International touring. Christ knows when that's going to come back, and touring in this country. Because it's not just the actors. You can sort of create your bubble, but how many people are going to want to offer you their digs? Yes, please come into my house. You know, it's so many computations within it.
Yeah.
So sadly, and you know, it seems very pessimistic, but I think realistically, theatre, I can't see being up and running until Easter of next year. Really.
Right. So when you talk about, obviously you talk about your passion being acting, if we go down to the next level then, in terms of the passion, you might kind of maybe intimated it a minute ago, but do you have more of a passion for certain parts, or do you have more of a passion for theatre versus TV? Does the passion layer down, if you like, to another level?
The instant reply would be that I have more passion for theatre. As I said just now, I think theatre is an actor's medium. It's absolutely the actor's medium. Because what should happen with a play is you do all your work before you start rehearsals, and then you do rehearsals with the director and all the other actors. And then after the first night, the director leaves and it becomes your show. It's the actor's show. We run it. You know, there's no one to stop you and no one to come on and go give you a note or anything. So whereas the television, you can't even know what shot they're going to use, you know, so you do a good scene. And then when you watch it, you go, oh, my God, you know, because I did something called Treadstone for Amazon Prime the year before, the summer of 2019, I did this thing called Treadstone for Amazon Prime, which was a spin-off, a sort of precursor to the Bournes. You know, Treadstone is Jason Bourne is from the Treadstone.
Yeah, thing. Yeah, absolutely.
So they made this thing called Amazon Prime, you know, I had a really nice part. I was the husband of the main one of the main characters, female CIA operative trying to close it all down, and I was a husband and we had a family. But when I saw the first scene that we shot, when it came out, they'd cut it to pieces, you know. The scene was quite simple, quite nice. And they'd actually taken a line from the beginning of the scene and put it at the end to make it seem different. So, you know, which has never happened to me before. So, you know, you really don't have any quality, you don't have any choice in the matter. Whereas with a play, that's my acting in theatre is my passion.
And how has, you mentioned Amazon Prime there, so how has the proliferation of television, I'm thinking particularly obviously Netflix and Amazon Prime, and even BT are getting in on the act now, and others are up, the cavalry's on the way in other areas, yeah, Disney.
Absolutely.
How has that changed the profession then in terms of that proliferation?
Well, I think it's, in many ways it's absolutely brilliant, because it does mean that there is a lot of work being made out there, a lot of scripts, and there is going to be, I mean, Netflix still seem to have stuff coming out, but they must all be chomping at the bit to get the scripts made that they've had in process probably for the last 18 months. But it's brilliant for actors, because there is much more work out there. And it used to be, say, I don't know, 6 or 7 years ago, if you went up for something for Sky or for Netflix, it would have been, wow, that's interesting, gosh, a Netflix series. But now, you know, they're around a lot, a huge amount, and you watch something on Netflix and you go, God, well, or for Sky, and you go, God, I know half that cast, you know. It's great, actually. It's great. I don't know what the pay is like, you know, but that's the other thing, you know. That's what's weird about it. I don't know what the deal is, you see, because, for instance, Treadstone is, you know, I got paid what I got paid. I also had to pay tax, Hungarian tax at source, right? So you get your fee, it's in dollars, then it's transmuted into sterling, and then you pay 15% at source Hungarian tax. So by the time I got it, it really was quite small, and it's now on Amazon Prime for eternity. So you don't get any repeat fees. So there's a sort of, I don't know, a fist in a velvet glove in some way, because they buy you out. And I think what'll happen is, again, it sounds quite pessimistic, but I think because TV companies are going to have to, and they already do have to do this already, is have a COVID thing, COVID insurance and COVID tests, actors will get paid less. They will just get paid less. That's generally what happens.
is it important to be, if you like, almost like continually seen and heard a little, to keep you in the, you know, in producers' minds or in agents' minds or whatever, just to be working, even if it's just being seen in smaller parts? Because, you know, it's like, rather than saying, oh yes, I appeared in something in 1974, is it better if you said
absolutely?
Yeah,
absolutely.
You just in public eye,
the more, absolutely. The more you work, and the more you know, because you know, you can be in something, in something called A Confession, which is the Martin Freeman thing, and I had a nice small part, but that was seen by a lot of people. That was out last year, maybe a year ago. No, not last year. No, God, year before. You know, the amount of people that saw Treadstone because it had a big, fairly big hype. Yeah, it's vital, you know, which is what's interesting about doing television is the amount of people that see it, obviously, compared to the amount of people that see you in a play. You know, so many more people are going to see you on television than will see you in a play.
Well, as I said, when I saw your picture, I recognised you straight away. So that maybe says something about it, because I've obviously seen you in things.
Yeah. And you probably don't really know where.
No, I'm probably not, if I'm honest. No, probably not. You know, but you just
know, because what happens is in that situation, you know, someone goes, I recognize you from the telly. What have you been in? And you go, well, I was in Heartbeat for 2 years. And they go, no, I didn't watch that. And you go through your credits. And they
go through your whole catalog.
Everything. And they go, no, I don't know. No. Have you done any adverts? And you go, yeah, I have done some adverts. And you find it's just from an advert. It's just.
It's interesting because I've done a fair amount of speaking engagements in my career, in my corporate career before I went out on my own, as they say, and self-employment, which is a few years now. I actually do some work with coaching people now who do speaking at events and such like. And you've got this thing, I don't know if you come across the term, but it's known as glossophobia, which is the fear of public speaking. So, in fact, it's interesting really, because, you know, in this age of everything's online now, yeah. You've got five fears that are all competing with each other to stop you doing video like this. You've got glossophobia, which is the fear of public speaking. You've got social phobia, which is the fear of being judged. You've got scopophobia, the fear of being seen on camera. You've got phonophobia, which is the fear of hearing your own voice. And then you've got technophobia, which is a fear of all the buttons and pressing the right things. So you can imagine all the different things. But the reason I raise it with you is do you still get really nervous when you step onto the boards, as they say, or is it something now that you can kind of take in your stride, or does it depend on which work you're doing?
I think it's the long answer to that is, you are, when the first moment you go on stage in front of an audience to do the play that you've worked on, you are, an actor friend of mine said that going on stage for an actor, what your body goes through chemically is similar to being in a car crash.
Wow.
Apparently, you know, the adrenaline. You get used to it and we can channel it without realizing it. But ideally, I think sporting metaphors are really, really useful as an actor. I think if you've prepared properly and you've done your work, so you've done the work before you start rehearsals, you've done all the work in rehearsals, you've really nailed the part, you've done all the preparation, and then it's simply mind games where you just think, okay, so I'm really nervous, but supposing the company stage manager came around and now to my dressing room and said, oh, listen, there's no audience tonight because there's no audience for the whole week, but we still got to do the show, you'd be absolutely devastated. So you have to play those mind games to go, if I don't get to show this, all this work that I've done, and create this character and show the audience this character, I'll be really, really upset. So I think the most I was ever nervous before, just that moment before going on stage, was when I played Hannay in the 39 Steps. And the first night of that, because I never go off stage as Hannay. And it's not that you go off stage to look at your script, but you just know the scenes come at you. But what you just have to do is trust it and trust yourself, because you've done all the hard work. All the lines will be there because they will be there because you've been trained. You've got the part nailed. But that was probably the most nervous I have been before the first night.
I think it's obviously perfectly normal. Do you find that if you're going to, when in business, you know, I often say to my clients in business, you know, put as many proposals in as you can and go and pitch as many times as you can, for the simple reason that the more you go in, the more rejection you get, the more resilient you get, the more maybe you'll get some feedback that makes you better. Is that the same philosophy for acting, where the more parts you go for, it makes you better and stronger? Or do you have to be more choosy about the parts you go for?
I am quite choosy about the parts I go for. It's less so in television, because you pretty much get asked to play roughly in your orbit. You know, there's a handful of actors who get to play more interesting characters on television, you know, but most of us are pretty much cast with how we are and what we bring to the party. And that's it. That's it. With theatre, you know, I get to play many more different, various different characters. Like, you know, playing Ed Boone, who's a central heating, you know, runs his own company in Curious Incident, which was just a brilliant part. And I was thrilled to get it because I knew I could play it. But I'm not obvious casting to play a London-based, from Swindon, boiler man, really. But I knew I could play it. I think, so I'm choosier, because also you look at all the parameters. You know, do you want to go away? Do you want to work with this director? It really has to be part director and sort of place, really, as a thing. But I think you get resilient throughout your career simply because you do go up for lots of parts, and you have to be committed to it. You can't, there's no point in going into the room if you don't really want the part, whichever it is, theatre or television. You'll let yourself down. You just won't do a good interview. So you have to want the job to even do a good interview. I've sort of taken myself down a rabbit hole there. I don't know.
Yeah, it often happens. No, I totally get it. I totally understand what you mean. I mean, funnily enough, I often say to clients in the business world that certainly if you're running a business or a small business, you have to live in a place just south of arrogant, because
I wondered if that's
kind of the same in your profession.
It is. That's a brilliant quote, actually. I shall be using that, Phil.
You can
I will name
no copyright.
But just south of arrogance is absolutely right. You do have to have incredible self-belief, you know, because the other thing I've sometimes said to people is, you know, I am essentially an entrepreneur. My business is me, and there's no guarantee that it'll work, and there never was any guarantee it'll work. But as I said at the very beginning, it is a calling. I have no option but to do it and pursue my dream. So that is what I've done. But you have to have incredible self-belief, really, because it is knocked sideways sometimes. It really is. You know, the amount of times you go for a job and all the ducks seem to be in a row. You go, yes, it, because the director was on that thing, and then that thing happened, and I didn't get that thing. So this now, it's sort of obviously the gods have, you know, and then it doesn't happen, you know. And you
exactly.
You put a lot of effort and so on into it. Yeah.
No, it's very, 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 very true. Okay, well, finally then, we came across each other. We were connected, if you like, by Saul Davis from the band James. Mm-hmm. And Saul is doing a online festival, you might call it, two-day music fest on the 28th and 29th January 2021, called Music Feeds. And Passions is very much behind it and supporting that. What are your thoughts on what he's doing in terms of two things, really? I guess providing music online in the way he's doing it, you know, in terms of the modern, the pandemic age, as they say, but also the whole area of that he's supporting and driving towards, which is supporting feeding people and feeding children to make sure that, in effect, nobody goes hungry.
Absolutely.
Any thoughts on it?
Well, I think it's incredible. Well, I think two things. I think what they're doing is incredible. And I think, so anybody who's within an artistic venture like this, who has gone, okay, we can't do this, so how are we going to do it? So to create basically a small scale Live Aid and stream it and get it done, make it happen, you know, remotely, completely remotely, is an extraordinary thing. And I take my hat off to Saul. I think it's incredible that they've actually got it together to make it happen. You know, I'm sure, you know, you can you can start off by having a great idea, and it probably wasn't plain sailing either, because these things aren't. There must have been real problems and technical glitches, and you know, how do we do that then? So to actually get ahead and make it happen is phenomenal. And so I think that's incredible. What I think about the fact of why they're doing it, in many ways, I think that's also incredible, but I think it's very disturbing and distressing that really in 2021 that it even has to happen, that children have to be at the forefront of a campaign. So Marcus Rashford, who's been extraordinary in what he's created, I think, because I do feel that his, I don't know if it's chicken and egg, but which came first, but what he brought up and brought to public consciousness has changed the game completely, you know. And the idea, I mean, I've been giving money to Magic Breakfast, which is it's in the independent newspaper, breakfast for certain schools up in the north, so not a blanket thing. You know, when you read the fact that, you know, I might get this wrong, but something like, I think it's 1 in 4 kids comes to school hungry. I mean, it's just, it's unforgivable that in one of the most prosperous economies in the world, even despite what's happened, that we actually have got children who go to school hungry and therefore can't concentrate and can't, I mean, I know they're not going to school at the minute, but you can't concentrate. Teachers are saying they can't concentrate because they're hungry. They cannot do anything, and they give them something to eat and then suddenly they can work. I mean, you wouldn't do it. Adults wouldn't go to that building if they hadn't had their breakfast and was expected to work. Well, it's sort of criminal, really, that we are in a situation, as I say, with one of the most prosperous countries in the world, and we don't somehow feed our children properly.
Yeah, we've got to figure it out. It's as simple as that, haven't we? We've just got to figure it out, and it can be complicated. It can get very political, of course, and it's easy to say, but sometimes it's a little bit more complex. But anyway, David, thanks ever so much for joining me today. I really appreciate it. It's been wonderful listening to the stories, and I've taken a lot from it personally. I always try and take something out of every interview I do, and I always do, and this is no exception at all. And once, I've actually given you something with the South of Arrogance quote.
You have? Oh, yes.
This is the first time.
I might even say it's mine, because I have one, you know, when I talk to actor friends and they've got some. Because it is part of the thing about being an actor is you need to look after your money. Because it seemed to me very early on, the last thing I wanted to ever do is be the kind of actor that when he gets a job, that job just pays off all the debts. So I have been fortunate to always, you know, but I have looked after my money. One of my quotes is sometimes, you know, you save for a rainy day, but sometimes you've got to accept that it's drizzling. So get your savings out. Saving for a rainy day, but accept the fact sometimes it's drizzling.
Yeah, and right now I'd imagine that's very relevant at the current moment in time. There'll be a lot of people surviving off those savings, actually. You know, cracking that, especially in your arena. So anyway, David, thanks very much for joining me. I really appreciate it. It's very enjoyable, and thanks for joining me today on Passions. I'll catch you maybe in the real world. I know you're from up here. Thank you, from this end of the northwest, Manchester, originally. So hopefully, maybe I'll meet you in the real world at some point in a coffee shop in Salford Keys or somewhere.
Yes, that would be great.
Okay, mate. Thanks very much indeed. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye bye.